not what I deserved, and nothing that I've earned but daily.
Oh, bless the Lord this day. Let us exalt his name together, for the Lord is good. His mercy endured forever. Good morning, saints, and welcome to the house of the Lord. It's Sunday morning, and I don't know about you, but I'm glad about it. I hope you are too. He said, enter into his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. So let us praise and worship the Lord together today. In Jesus' name, amen. Happy Mother's Day to all the mothers out there. We wish you a blessed day in Jesus' name. Let not your heart be troubled, be heavy, be grieving. Rejoice in the Lord. And again, I say rejoice this day. We're so glad you're tuning in with us here at Trinity East United Methodist Church. We want to welcome you to the service. But before we begin, I want to do announcements for today, as well as our offering. Announcements, we just encourage you, invite you to join us on Monday nights at 8 o'clock for prayer. Prayer changes things. The effective fervent prayer of the righteous availeth much. Also on Thursdays at 6 p.m. for Bible study, as we come and study the word of God. His word is a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path. We have the information for Monday night as well as Thursday evening on our website. We do it by Zoom. You can tune in on your computer electronically, or you can call, dial in. We have the information on our website at www.trinityeastumc.org. Join us on Monday nights. Join us on Thursday night. We welcome you. We'll be so glad to have you. A family that prays together, a family that studies the word together, stays together. Before we move any further into our service, I would like to give you this opportunity to give, because we are called to be givers. The Bible says, give and it shall be given unto you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over blessings. So we want you to be able to plant seeds into good soil here at Trinity East, where we take those seeds and we allow God to bless them, to break them, and multiply them as we give them out to help others in our community and in this world. We thank you for always sharing with us and all you've already done to bless this ministry so that we can continue going in the name of Jesus. There are many ways you can give here at Trinity East. You can go on our website at www.trinityeastumc.org. There's a give button. You click that button and you can give to this ministry. Also, you can go on Giveify. We have Cash App. We have PayPal. All kinds of ways that you can give here at Trinity East. And as I always say, you can do good old snail mail. So we just want to thank you, and we want to praise God for givers, those who give. And even if you don't have anything to give, I want you to raise your hand right where you are. We're going to pray together for God to, he knows our heart. If you have the heart to give, God honors that. So would you raise up your seed wherever you are right now, and we're going to ask God to bless our giving. The Heavenly Father, we thank you for this opportunity to give. Father God, we just thank you that you've blessed us to be a blessing. And everything we have, everything we shall have, it belongs to you, God. And you've allowed us to be good stewards. You said just give you 10% back, God. And we keep the 90, and then you bless the 10% and give us more back for that. We thank you. We don't give because we're to get, Father God. We just give to say, thank you, Lord, from a glad heart, a grateful spirit, so grateful that you are our God and all that you've already done for us. We can't thank you enough, God. So I ask, thank you for the ones who are giving, those who have a desire to give, but have not been able to give yet, God, that you touch them, oh God, that you open doors for them, oh God. And when the door is open in their financial blessing, they will remember that the source is truly you, not the job, but you, oh God. So we thank you in advance, and we give you the glory and honor and praise for everything. In Jesus' name, amen. As I've already said, we're so glad you tuned in to worship with us today on this Mother's Day. We thank you for that. And we have a guest speaker with us today. Minister Damian Russell will be bringing the message today. So after the singing of the praise team, the next voice you will hear is Minister Damian Russell. Be blessed.
We honor our great God today as we celebrate mothers, those who have given birth, those who are mothers by proxy, those who have raised children that weren't their own. We celebrate you today on this wonderful Mother's Day. As we prepare to share God's word with you, we want to thank Pastor White for the opportunity to come to Trinity East and share with you what God has placed upon my heart. And I hope some of you won't be too angry at me. This won't be a traditional Mother's Day service or a traditional Mother's Day sermon, but it's certainly what God gave to me to give to you, his people. So with that being said, I'd like to pray. I'm going to share with you what God has shared with me, and then we're going to get this thing done. Father, how we thank you for our time together on this Mother's Day, this second Sunday. And Father, we ask now that you would bless our time together. Father, for those that are here with us and those that are watching, Father, in this city, in this county, in this country, and across this world, we ask that this word would be relevant to your people's hearts, minds, and lives. Father, that because of your word, we might be transformed from the inside out. I pray, Holy Spirit of God, that you would use me to the glory and to the honor of you. Father, that your people's lives might be changed. We bless you and we thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. We're excited today. For those of you that are streaming with us, we ask that you would open up now your Bibles. I'll give you a moment to go gather your family, gather your friends, or whoever that you are with. Put your mask on, do your social distancing, or whatever that you're doing, but grab your Bibles. And once you get your Bibles and you come back, come into your living rooms, into your bedrooms, wherever you might be, so we can share God's word with you. We want to thank you on behalf of Pastor White and Trinity East for allowing us to come into your home today, to come into your living rooms, into your bedrooms, into your dens. Some of you might be even sitting in your backyard. Some of you might be streaming while you're riding, but wherever this finds you, we're grateful that you are here with us today. So if you've gotten your Bibles now, I ask that you would open up your Bibles to the book of Isaiah chapter 6. Isaiah chapter 6. I'm going to be reading from the New American Standard Version of the Bible. May read a little differently if you have the NIV or the King James or the New King James, but it's God's word nevertheless. Isaiah chapter 6, I'll give you just a moment to find it. I'll read it into your hearing, then I'll share with you what God has shared with me. Isaiah chapter 6, if you're there, say amen. Isaiah chapter 6, reading out of the New American Standard Version of the Bible, here's what it says. It says, in the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord. I saw the Lord high and exalted, seated on a throne, and the train of his robe filled the temple. I'm going to read that again for you into your hearing. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord high and exalted, seated on a throne, and the train of his robe filled the temple. For the time that it is ours to share, I'd like to speak from this thought. I want to talk about tragedy, God's agent for change and transformation. I'm going to say it again so that you might write this down, that you might share it later with your family members or friends. Today, we're going to talk about tragedy, God's agent for change and transformation, out of Isaiah chapter 6 and verse number 1. So let's get into it. Cells are often called the building blocks of life. One, they multiply constantly. Two, they give rise to new organisms. Cells, you could essentially say they create life. Now, this is by no means a biology lesson. Instead, it's a means to create a picture in our minds about something that's being built. In the year that King Uzziah died, it's not to change or to build Isaiah or us on a cellular level, but it's to change us and challenge us on a spiritual level. See, God intends today, by way of his word, to use tragedy to build and to develop us into the image of his beloved son. Come on, say amen. I know it's tough, but we're going to get there. What I want you to understand today is that God wants us to be transformed by the renewing of our minds. And today, he's going to use tragedy to show us how that transformation takes place. And all of us ought to be able to relate right now, because we're living right now in some very tragic times. Sometimes we've never seen, sometimes we've never witnessed, but tragedy nevertheless. But God wants us to know something else. What does God want us to know? He wants us to know that if any man be in Christ, he is a new creation. All things have been passed away, and all things have become new. Those are the things that God wants us to know. But watch this. There are some things that I want to give you right out of God's word. See, God was then, and God is now building something. So the question is this. So let me pose you this question to you. What was God building in 739 BC? Because 739 BC is the year that King Uzziah died, that he's also trying to build in 2020. That's a great question. May I answer it for you? Here's what God is trying to build. God is trying to build kingdom people to carry out his kingdom agenda. That's what God is trying to build. If that's what God is trying to build, the next question is what's God's agenda? That's a great question. So what is God's agenda? Can I tell you what that is? Or suggest to you what that agenda is? God wants to use a visible demonstration of the comprehensive rule of God over every area of our lives. Let me say that a little simply. Here's what God's agenda is. He wants us to follow his rule. He wants us to follow his plan. He wants us to follow his program. What does that mean? God wants to build a theocratic society. What does that mean? That's just a word that means God wants to rule. He doesn't want us to build a homocratic society. What does that mean? That means a society that's ruled by men. God wants to use tragedy to show us how powerful and wonderful he really is. But there's some other things that I need to show you before I get into the tapestry of this text. Let me show you why God has you and me in his kingdom. Can I suggest to you why he has us as a part of his kingdom? Daniel, that great prophet, in chapter 7, verses 13 and 14, here's what he writes. He says, I kept looking in the night visions, and behold, with the clouds of heaven, one like the Son of Man was coming. The Son of Man is the Lord Jesus Christ. And it says he came up to the Ancient of Days. The Ancient of Days is God the Father. And he was presented before him. So we see a picture of the Lord Jesus Christ being presented to his Father. The question becomes, why is that presentation being made? Verse 14 says, and to him by his Father, the Lord Jesus Christ was given some things. What was he given? He was given dominion. He was given glory, and he was given a kingdom. It goes on to say the reason it was given to him so that all people, that means everybody, all nations, doesn't matter what continent you might be on, men of every language, whether you speak English or German or Russian or Chinese, God wants to do some things in your life. He says he gave him everlasting dominion, which will never pass away. And his kingdom, which is one, will never be destroyed. What God wants us to understand is the precedences that he set were good yesterday. They are good today, and they will be good forevermore. But watch this, because that's not all I see. See, we were brought into God's kingdom to serve him, to do his will, and to confiscate from Satan those things that belong to God. You do know Satan has stole some things from you, don't you? And you do know God has given you the authority to go into the hand of the enemy, go behind enemy lines, and take back everything that the devil stole from you. Are you ready to get back what was stolen from you? But watch this. The text would teach us that Isaiah learned and wants to teach us that the kingdom of God operates this way. How? According to God's will. See, most of us wants to do God's thing our own way. But I want to let you know today that God has a will that he expects us to follow. But watch this as we get into the text. Isaiah, according to Isaiah 6:1, had just experienced a tragedy. And from that tragedy, three characters emerge. Can I tell you who they are? One is King Uzziah, but he just died. The other is Isaiah the prophet, whose prophetic ministry just started when Uzziah died. And the third person is our great God, and we call him Yahweh. Now, with that being said, and these characters being introduced, I want to give you a few things, a few nuggets that I dug right out of this text. Can I give it to you today? The first thing I want you to understand is tragedy unveiled God's grace. I'm going to say it again, just in case you missed it. Tragedy unveils God's grace. Now, some of you say, hey, Damon, what do you mean? How is grace unveiled through Uzziah's death? All unveiled means is something that was covered has now been uncovered. And what God wants to show you in tragedy is that he is still a gracious, loving, and kind God. So, Damon, how can we learn about God's grace through the death of Uzziah? How can we learn about God's grace through the death of anything? How can we learn about God's grace? Great question, and I'm glad you asked. Because here's the thing I need you to hear. Hear me well. See, you can be a kingdom person not having been a perfect king. I'm gonna say it again. You can be a kingdom person not having been a perfect parent. You can be a kingdom person not having been a perfect pastor. You can be a kingdom person not having been a perfect father. You can be a kingdom person not having been a perfect son, a perfect daughter, a perfect teacher, a perfect president, a perfect governor. All I want you to understand is God is not looking for perfect people, but he is looking for kingdom people. And if you are sitting there today and you are watching, I want you to know God is looking for kingdom people. But see, tragedy unveils God's grace. How is that possible? So while we're looking at Isaiah chapter 6 and verse 1, that's not where this story begins. Uzziah's story starts in 2 Kings chapter 15. And it goes over into 2 Chronicles chapter 26. So how does tragedy unveil God's grace? How can we be kingdom people and not be perfect people? That's a great question. Because when we find Uzziah in 2 Kings chapter 16 and in 2 Chronicles 26, can I tell you a secret? Chris, watch this. He's only 16 years old. He's only 16 years old in 2 Chronicles chapter 26. At 16, he was anointed king. But that's not all I see. Watch this. In 2 Chronicles 26, 5b, watch what it says. It says, as long as he, talking about Uzziah, but his name in Chronicles was also Azariah. So when you look over there and you don't see Uzziah's name, you'll see Azariah's name, and it's talking about the same person. It said, as long as he sought the Lord, God gave him success. What God wants you to understand, and not being perfect, but being kingdom, that if you follow him, he'll give you great success. But that's not all it teaches us in 2 Chronicles 26 and 7, verse 8. Watch what it said. It said, God helped him, talking about King Uzziah, to against his enemies. Who was his enemies? The Philistines. Watch this. God, when you follow him, you don't have to be perfect. You just have to be kingdom. He'll give you victory even over your adversaries. But watch what happens. Everybody say, uh-oh. In 2 Kings 26 and 16, you know what happened to Uzziah? That happened to Azariah? That often happens to most of us. We get beside ourselves. God gives a little something. He does a little something for us, and we get beside ourselves. Because in 26:16:8, here's what it said. It said Uzziah became powerful. And when he became powerful, his pride led to his downfall. Watch what the Bible says. Pride goes before what? Destruction. And a haughty spirit, guess what? Before a fall. So you better be careful when God does great things for us, that we don't get beside ourselves. Don't get lost, because I'm still talking about the fact that tragedy unveils God's grace. When you go over to chapters 19 and 20, watch what Uzziah did. In 2 Chronicles 26, 19 and 20, it said the king tried to operate like a priest and offer incense to God. See, the Bible says it like this. He gave some to be prophets. He gave some to be apostles and pastors and teachers. What does that mean? God is simply saying, stay in your lane. Do the thing that God has called you to do. But even if you get outside your lane, when your Uzziah dies, what God will show us is even in that tragedy, God has still been gracious to us. Even when we get it wrong, even when we get outside of our lane, just like Uzziah did, the grace of God prevails. What I want you to understand in this tragedy, as God uses us to change us and transform us, is that tragedy unveils God's grace. But that's not all I see. Watch this. Follow me. The second thing I want you to understand is tragedy unmasks man's need for revival. I'm going to say it again. Tragedy unmasks man's need for revival. Here's what the text said. It said, I saw the Lord. And how did I see him? He was high. That means he was above everything else. He said, I saw the Lord. How did I see him? He was exalted. That means he was in his permanent and personal position. He said, I saw the Lord. How did I see him? He was seated on a throne. That means he was sitting in the place of honor. But don't miss this. Tragedy unmasks man's need for revival. Can I give you a secret that you might miss in this text? Watch this. Isaiah knew the Lord before King Uzziah died. I'm gonna give you a chance to soak that in for a minute. Isaiah knew the Lord before King Uzziah died. If that's true and it is, then what's the point? See, even though he knew the Lord before King Uzziah died, watch this. He didn't see the Lord until Uzziah died. And that's a difference. See, you can know the Lord and not see the Lord. And see, what he's trying to teach us as his sons and his daughters is most of us have just had a sighting and not had an experience. And God wants to have an experience with us, and he uses tragedy to unmask us, to show us for the kind we really are. But see, that's not necessarily a bad thing, because in order to see something, sometimes you got to take the mask off. Too many times as believers, see, we ought to be celebrating Christmas and we ought to be celebrating Easter and things like that. But you know what we like as believers? We like Halloween. You know why we like Halloween? Because we like to put masks on and we like to pretend to be something that we're not. And we like to do things like that. But see, what God will do in tragedy is God will take the mask off. God will reveal your face for what sort it is. But you know what I love about God? See, God doesn't unmask us so he can one-up us like people do. God unmasks us so that through tragedy, he can change us and transform us. It's right here in the text. Even as believers, we need revival. See, Isaiah knew the Lord, but it was on that day when Uzziah died that he saw the Lord. Watch this. God has a sense of humor. You know what Uzziah means in the Greek? Uzziah means strength. So watch what that means. God reveals us and unmasks us when our strength dies. See, because too many of us are trying to do God's thing in our own strength. Too many of us are trying to accomplish God's will in our own strength. And watch what God does. He pulls the mask off. You know why? Because we need revival. Can I give you another thing? Watch this. While you're lamenting your loss, don't miss the lesson. I'm going to say it again. While you're lamenting your loss, don't miss the lesson. Yes, lament over your loved ones and lament over the loss of friends. It's all right to lament over a lost job or a business, because this COVID-19 thing has turned the world upside down. It's all right to lament over the loss of health, whether that health is mental health, whether that health is physical health, because to date, 3.96 million people have lost their lives to the coronavirus. Lament over the lost seniors of your graduation, walking across that stage, and your prom. It's all right to lament over loss But in your lamenting, don't miss God's lesson. Can I tell you something that we probably don't like to hear? That's going to mess with some of your theology, but let me put it out there anyway. Sometimes, watch what God does. Sometimes tragedy and negative circumstances allow us to see God. For most of us, we ran into God and we saw him for the very first time when something happened that we did not like or we could not control. And Isaiah was lamenting over the death of Uzziah because for 52 years he had reigned over the southern kingdom because the kingdoms were divided. In those 52 years, Judah had prospered like under no other king. So sometimes we might lament over the loss of a person, but sometimes we lament over what that person brought to our lives. It's called loss, but watch this. Because sometimes, you know what tragedy will do? Tragedy will give us a new perspective. Tragedy will clear away the haze. Tragedy will give us a new outlook. Tragedy will give us a new vision, because there are times when we need, as God's sons and daughters, to be revived. You're looking at me right now, wherever you're sitting, in your living room, in your bathroom, in your car, with your children, by yourself, and you're saying, as a believer, you think you've got it all together, but God wants to pull the mask off. You think because you know a few scriptures and you can quote them, God wants to pull the mask off. Can I show you the biggest mask that God has pulled off? Watch this. This place that I'm standing in right now, called the church. Watch what God wants to teach us. This is the place we come on Sundays for worship. But all the things that people are doing now to help their neighbors and help their friends and help their communities, God pulled the mask off, because watch what he's saying. That's what you ought to be doing anyway. Why does it take COVID-19 for my people to stand up and do what I already commissioned them to do? But that's not all I see. Watch this. Because God is not just interested in getting us to heaven. He wants us to see him right here on earth. See, some of us are so worried about trying to get to heaven, we're not doing much in this place called time that God has given us. A couple of more things and I'm done, I promise. Now watch what the text said. The text said, above him, above God, were seraphim. And it describes them. It said they had six wings. Is that in your Bible? It said it had six wings with two wings that covered their faces. That means the holiness of God was shining so bright, they knew that you can't look upon God with an unfettered gaze. It said that two covered their feet. That means they were saying, God, we are lonely and we don't deserve to be here. And it said with the other two, they flew. Now, while they were flying, watch what the Bible says. Watch what the imagery that Isaiah gives us. It said they were shouting back and forth, and watch what they were saying. They were saying, holy, holy, holy is the Lord Almighty. And they said, they were saying it so convincingly and so loud, it said that the earth was filled with his glory. It's right here in the text. It said that the sound of their voices made things start to shake. Let me ask you a question. When was the last time you praised God so loud, so long, that it affected the atmosphere? When was the last time you praised God with such fervor that everything around you started moving? Until you're ready to offer God that kind of praise, you might not get the result that you're looking for. But watch this. God brought Isaiah behind the veil, and he allowed Isaiah to watch that happen. He allowed Isaiah to come into his presence. Watch the difference between the response of the seraphim and the response of Isaiah. Because here's the next thing I want to show you. Tragedy unleashes God's sanctifying work. Watch this. Tragedy unleashes God's sanctifying work. When Isaiah saw, felt, and entered into the presence of God, he didn't say, glory, hallelujah. He didn't say, you know what, since I met Jesus, I done laid my burdens down. Verse 5 said, he said, woe unto me. I cried. I am ruined. This is in verse number 5. You know why? Because I'm a man of unclean lips. And I live among a people of unclean lips, but my eyes have seen the King. Watch what tragedy does. Unless Uzziah died, unless there is loss, there are times that we can't get what we need from God until tragedy strikes. But tragedy unleashes the sanctifying work of God. Listen, when you find yourself in the presence of God, if you don't bow your head and fall down to your knees, that means you caught up in yourself. Because when we go into the presence of God, when we see his righteousness and our unrighteousness, it ought to call us to say, woe is me. But we got so beside ourselves now. With our fine homes, and ain't nothing wrong with that. And our educational pursuits, there is nothing wrong with that. With our clothes that we wear, our red bottom shoes, nothing wrong with that. But when you enter into the presence of God, do you recognize he's trying to do a sanctifying work in us? Because whether you want to believe it or not, there is some stuff in us that needs to come out. There is some stuff in us that needs to be purified. The presence of God reveals my true self. It shows me for what I really am. But watch this. He said, I'm ruined. Watch what that means. That means I'm coming unstitched. That means my life is falling apart. Things are unraveling. Sin is prevalent. And my current state is beyond what I can handle on my own. Are you willing to admit today, my brother, my sister, my friend, my neighbor, that your life is unraveling? Are you willing today to admit the fact that some things about us mentally, emotionally, spiritually, psychologically are coming unstitched? And you need somebody to fix that thing up. God wants to do a sanctifying work in our lives. But you know what? In order for him to sanctify us, we first got to admit the fact that we need him. A few weeks ago, I bought a jacket. I love that jacket. And when I wore it, I must admit that I looked quite good in it. But the last time I wore the jacket, when I took it off, I noticed that right here on the shoulder in the back, the stitching was coming loose. And I must admit, I was a little bothered because first, I paid good money for that jacket. Secondly, it was a jacket that I really loved. Third, I hadn't had it long enough for the stitching to become loose. But watch what I did not do. I did not take that jacket and discard it because the stitching was coming out. Watch what I did. I got on my phone and I Googled where is the nearest tailor or alteration shop close to where I live. Because you know what I knew? If I could just get this jacket to somebody that could put the stitching back in it, when they got it back to me, it would be just like new. I'm talking to you today, my brother and my sister. The stitching of your life might be coming loose, but don't throw your friend away. Don't throw your wife away. Don't throw your mother away. Don't throw your children away. Don't throw this nation away. Give this nation, give your family, give your finances, give your future as it's unraveling to somebody that can stitch that thing back up again. And I guarantee you, it'll wear just like new. Tragedy unleashes God's sanctifying work. Because watch what you got to do. Repentance activates grace. Repentance activates mercy. Repentance activates compassion. Repentance activates regeneration. Listen, all God wants to do is make us new. This COVID-19 and this pandemic has done some strange and unusual things that this world has never seen before. But can I tell you that though this pandemic may have caught others by surprise, can I tell you who it didn't catch by surprise? It didn't catch our great God by surprise. But watch this. It says, once he repented, once he came to grips with the fact that he needed the Lord, when you look at verse 6, I love the first word in verse 6, because the Bible says, if you confess your sin, God is faithful and just to forgive us of our sin and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Watch what verse 6 of chapter 6, the first word, it says, then. I need everybody to say then. Once we've done what God requires of us, once we acknowledge to him that we need him, then God will act on our behalf. Because when Isaiah did that, one of the seraphim that had been attending to God, watch what God did. God allowed for an angelic intervention. That seraphim came over to Isaiah, went to the coal where the fire was burning, took one of the coal off of it, brought it over and put it on Isaiah's lips, and watch what he said. He said, your fault is gone and your sin has been forgiven. See, that's great news right there. See, you don't have to be a perfect person. You just got to be a kingdom person who is willing, when you bump into God, to compare yourself to him and recognize how much you need him. He says that was an angelic intervention, but watch this. In this angelic intervention, you know what I believe? I believe this is what they call, in hermeneutic terms, a theophany. What is a theophany? A theophany simply means it's Jesus Christ in angelic form. So Damon, why do you believe that this is Jesus Christ in angelic form? The reason I believe that is because the Bible says that there is only one who can pardon sin, and his name is Jesus. And this seraphim said, your sins have been forgiven. That's a great point, and let me pause right there for just a moment. See, I don't care what the nation of Islam tells you, only Jesus can pardon sin. I don't care what the priest and the pastor or anybody teaches you, only Jesus can pardon sin. Let me say it like this. The writer of the book of Acts said that there's only one name under heaven by which men shall be saved, and it's the name Jesus Christ. I love you with my whole heart. Pastor White loves you with a whole heart. But guess what? The only person that can forgive sin is the Lord Jesus Christ. Now watch this. Tragedy unearths God's plan and purpose for us. Because in this tragedy, he said, then I heard the voice of the Lord. Now, when you compare that to verse 1, in verse 1, he saw something. But in this verse, he said, I heard something. What did he hear? What did the Lord say? The Lord didn't say anything. The Lord asked him a question. And here is the question that he asked. Who will go for us? And whom shall I send? God is looking for some kingdom people to go for him. Because in tragedy, our calling can be revealed. God wants to know, are there men, are there women, are there children, are there teens who are willing to go? Because tragedy, it unearths God's plan and purpose. Because you know what? Isaiah wasn't comfortable. Isaiah didn't know until Uzziah died. And once Uzziah died, Uzziah meaning strength, the thing that moved Isaiah away from his purpose, sometimes God will move stuff. God will take stuff so that we can meet him face to face. Watch this. See, Isaiah got to know the will of God. And he got to know the power to do the will of God when he saw God. Listen, my brothers and my sisters. Have you seen God? Have you had that experience with him? Because see, when we become kingdom people through tragedy, watch what God will do. When we become kingdom people through tragedy, God will restructure our thoughts. He will restructure our words. He will restructure our deeds. He will even restructure the standards by the way we live our lives. But tragedy unearths God's purpose and plan for our lives. And I'm done. Finally, lastly, tragedy uncovers the gateway to triumph. If you didn't hear anything I said before now, listen to me now. Tragedy uncovers the gateway to triumph. The text would show us there are two things that ensure triumph and victory. What are those two things? In verse 1, watch what we saw. It says he was seated on the throne and the train of his robe filled the temple. Is that in your Bible? Verse 1. But watch what verse 13 said. Because from verse 13 all the way back up to verse 8, Isaiah was saying, God, you know these people aren't going to listen to me. God, you know these people don't want to hear what I have to say. God, you know they're going to go their own way. They're going to do their own thing. Why? Their hearts are calloused. And their ears are dull. Their hearts won't understand. But the question still is, who's going to go for us? And who will we send? Why? Because tragedy uncovers the gateway to triumph. Two ways. He was seated on the throne, and the train of his robe filled the temple. In verse 13, watch what it says. Don't miss this. It says, so the holy seed will be the stump in the land. Let me see if I can't put this together. Watch this. Anybody want to live in victory? Anybody want to live in triumph? I want to show you that tragedy is God's agent for change and for transformation. Watch this. Watch how these two things fit together. When he was seated on the throne and the train of his robe filled the temple, what does that mean? How do we triumph from victory during tragedy? How do we put these things together? Because the train, watch what it represents. It represents the power of the one who is seated on the throne. Don't miss this. Watch this. Because in those days, watch how a king's train got long. A king's train got longer every time he defeated another king. He would take the defeated king's train and sew it to his train. And so when people saw him and his train, and when they saw how long his train was, they knew he was good at defeating his adversary. Come on, let me see if I can't help you. Can I tell you what Jesus defeated? Can I tell you why his train is so long? Because Jesus had defeated Satan, sin, and death. Jesus had defeated addiction. He's defeated poverty. Can I tell you why Jesus' train is so long? He has defeated injustice, insanity, and loneliness. Can I tell you why Jesus' train is so long? Because he has defeated curses. He has defeated lost legacies. He has defeated insecurities. Can I tell you why Jesus' train is so long? Because he has defeated accusation and brokenness. The train of the field, the temple. But that was another thing. It's called seed. Everybody say seed. The Bible says that the seed of Jesse is where Jesus came from. Follow me. I'm on my way somewhere. Come on, go with me. So the two ways we live in victory and triumph is a seated Savior and the seeds that he has provided for our lives. Can I tell you some of the things in tragedy that Jesus has planted in your life through seed? He has planted hope and love. He has planted joy and compassion. Even in tragedy. In tragedy, he has planted the seeds of reconciliation and peace. Some of you, today is Mother's Day. You need to call your mom and let your mom know how much you love her, because reconciliation has been planted in your life. You know what else he's planted? He's planted peace and health. He's planted forgiveness and wisdom. He has planted understanding and justice. Don't think for a moment that that father and son in Georgia has gotten away with the thing. You know why? Because the eyes of the Lord are in every place, beholding the evil and the good. The Bible says, let justice roll down like a mighty stream. Whatever man does or does not do, God has taken an account of all these things. Why? He's planted seeds. You know why? Because tragedy uncovers the gateway to triumph. And I'm done. Watch this. I told you that I want to talk about tragedy, God's agent for change and transformation. If you're listening to me now, wherever you're sitting, wherever you're laying, wherever you're standing, God wants to change and transform your life even during these tragic times. I know some families that have suffered, the Edwards family, Tori and her family, some insurmountable tragedies. But listen to me well. It's in tragedy that God does his best work. Isaiah proves that to us. And how does he do that? Because tragedy unveils God's grace. Do you need God's grace today? He can give it to you, even in tragedy. Tragedy unmasks man's need for revival. We are his. We have been set apart and called apart, but you know what? We need reviving every single day. Tragedy unleashes God's sanctifying work. Allow him to come into that place, into that space where you are right now, and sanctify you right where you are. Tragedy unearths God's plan and his purpose for us. Maybe you were struggling as to why God put you here, why God created you, because some tragic things have happened in your life. Maybe you were molested, maybe you were abandoned. But in that tragedy, God will bring purpose and God will have a plan. Because you know what he said? I know the plan that I have for you. To bring you a future and a hope, God can meet you right where you are. Finally, tragedy uncovers the gateway to triumph. God intends for us to live victorious lives because he himself was victorious over anything and everything that would hold us down. He says, what shall separate us from the love of God? And the answer to that question is absolutely nothing. A songwriter far wiser than myself, as I close, said this. And my cousin sang it some years ago very prophetically, and it says that tragedies are commonplace. It says there are all kinds of diseases people are slipping away. Sounds like 2020. It says that the economy's down. People can't get enough pay, but it said, ask for me. All I can say, but I won't give you the punchline because there's more to it. He says there are folks without homes living out in the streets and drug habits, some say, they just can't beat. Muggers and robbers, no place seems to be safe. But Lord, you've been my protection every step of the way. I'm not going to give you the punchline yet. Watch what it said. It said it could have been me. Outdoors, with no food and no clothes, or watch this, or left alone, without a friend or just another number with a tragic end. But it said, but you know what, God? You saw fit to let none of these things be. Every day by your power, you keep on keeping me. Here's the punchline. It says, all I want to say is thank you, Lord, for all you've done for me. If that's you today, if tragedy is a commonplace, just tell him thank you. Not for the tragedy, but for the fact that he'll meet you right where you are. Maybe you're here today and you don't know this sitting Savior. Maybe you are here today and you don't know the seed of Jesse and his name is Jesus Christ. Maybe you don't know him in the pardon of your sin, but right here, right now, in this day, on this time, he wants to save you. All you have to do is confess with your mouth and believe in your heart that God has raised Christ from the dead, and the Bible says you shall be saved. But maybe you're like me, and maybe you're like Pastor White, and maybe you're like Chris. We met the Lord a long time ago, but tragedy came. We're not praying like we should. We're not meditating like we should. Maybe you need God to do a sanctifying work in you. Maybe you need revival right now, right here. God can do it. Even as we're streaming online, we don't have to be in the same room. We don't have to be in the same space. Fathers, go get your wives and see if they need the Lord Jesus Christ. Mothers, go get your children and see if they need the Lord Jesus Christ. Put your mask on and walk to your neighbor's house and say, neighbor, I'm not going to get within 6 feet of it, but do you know the Lord Jesus Christ and the pardon of your sin? Because as we celebrate Mother's Day, my mother has taken me on trips. My mother has clothed me and fed me most of my life. I lost my mother some years ago, but you know why I'm standing here today? Because my mother, of all the gifts that she gave me, the greatest gift she ever gave me was the Lord Jesus Christ. Today, Jesus Christ wants to change your life. You know how he's going to do it? Through tragedy, an agent for change and transformation. Amen.
Christ loved me, and it's not what I deserved, and nothing that